Hello everyone, this is Al-Fadi, and this is a continuation of a brand new series that we just started, it myself and Dr. Bill Warner, on the status of women in Islam. Last time we kind of like gave just an introduction to the topic itself. Today we are going to dig a little bit deeper, get into the weeds if you wish, and we'll begin to uncover some troubling teachings that are found in Islamic primary sources, the Quran or the Hadith for instance, and how these primary sources do not in any way show equality between male and female. Bill, you alluded to a chapter last time, and you said it, you know, you mentioned chapter 4 verse 34, and I knew exactly what you meant by that. What is it about that particular verse in chapter 4 that you found to be troubling?
Well, not only does verse 434 say that men are superior to women or that women are inferior to men, but it goes ahead to say that if they don't act in a manner you like or even have a bad attitude, you can beat them.
Did you hear what he said? You know, in there, it doesn't give you justification why, for instance, a woman should be beating. It says, if you fear disloyalty, if you fear, you know, something from them, maybe you assumed that they have bad attitude. Maybe your wife came back later. She said, I will be home at 8 in the evening. She came at 8:30, and you're like, oh, you're cheating on me. That's enough.
Right.
That's more than enough for you to activate this command, basically.
And it says, beat them. It doesn't. Now, by the way, sometimes people ask me, this is a sidebar, what about a good translation of a Quran? Because there's this myth that it depends heavily on how you translate it. I say, go to verse 434. If it says beat them, it's a good translation. If it says beat them lightly, it's a bad translation.
And guess what, Bill? You know, lately I'm not finding anyone that is a good translation anymore about that verse, because they begin to understand that there is something embarrassing here.
Well, it should be embarrassing. It's wrong.
Exactly. So if we go to the wife beating, for instance, Muhammad, the prophet of Islam, did beat his wife. For instance, in one of the hadith, this one is found in Bukhari, in Muslim, book number 4, hadith number 2127, this is what it says. He, speaking of Muhammad, struck me, this is Aisha was talking about that, on the chest, which caused me pain. Now, the background behind this hadith was interesting. Muhammad supposedly went outside at nighttime, right? Mm-hmm. You know, so she was curious about why did he leave at nighttime. So she followed him without telling him that I'm gonna follow you. He noticed, you know, he's smart. You know, he noticed someone was following him, and then later he recognized who was following him. So when he came back, she pretended, you know, she, you know, kind of like sprung back home. She pretended she was asleep. He came in and says, why are you out of breath? And he started questioning her. So she told him, you know, that something that he didn't like, and he kind of like accused her of lying to him, and he stuck his finger in her chest like this. And she said it was painful. Now, let me ask you, this is the prophet of Islam who's the model, right? Is this how you ought to treat your wife, for instance, if, let's say, she didn't want to tell you? Maybe she's planning a surprise party for you, you know, and she don't want to tell you. Is that how you treat her?
Well, I've been married for 56 years. Let me assure you that being married involves a certain amount of stress and strain. And I can understand the impulse to strike a woman, but I've never actually done so because it is wrong to do so. But again, I can understand the urge. Because living together with a woman for as long as I have, now then, let me follow this up by saying that now then, things run very smooth, thank you. But getting it all started out was a little rough in spots, but I never struck her because it is wrong to do so.
Absolutely. I mean, it's just not the right attitude, not the right, really, that's not how a gentleman ought to act anyway. I mean, I find it interesting because Muslim women lately in this culture, in the contemporary culture we live in, they find this to be really oppressive behavior. They find it to be unkind, unjust. But they overlook the fact that the husband actually is following his own commands. Mm-hmm. He's enacting what he was told to be, that's the model set for you. So what is the dilemma here for a Muslim woman then?
I've wondered about this a lot. I've also wondered about this question. Why do women in America become Muslim?
That's right.
And yet they do. And I figured out there's good reasons for this. Well, I've already established that I think women are equal to men in their thinking process. So what is the reasons that some American women marry a Muslim man? And I've come up with this list. Number one, the Muslim man wants a family and wants to be a husband, and it's hard to find a husband in our society today. The other thing is you can be
the Muslim woman, you mean?
Yes.
Yeah.
You can be a Muslim woman and stay at home. You don't have to be a professional. You can raise children, as is a natural instinct. So and also the man is supposed to bring home enough to live on, and he's not supposed to cheat on you. So you look and you go, okay, he's not going to cheat on me. He's going to bring money at home. I can live a life as a mother. This is a good deal. Now remember, I went through and I cataloged three categories of women's treatment: superior, equal, and inferior. And so they do find qualities in there that are enough to feel good about it. But verse 434 hangs over her head. If he wants to, he can strike her.
Yeah. Let's show that a slide, by the way, about how women actually, from your assessment that you made,
yes,
look at the high status, the equal status, and the low status.
Well, this tells a very sad story, I'm afraid. High status means you're a mother, and that's less than 1%. Equal status is 10%. But actually, even the equal status, which is equal on Judgment Day, is modified by the fact that one of your rules as a woman is to, 434, to be subjugated by the husband. And then we have low status, and that can be manifest in many ways, whether it's sex slaves, being beaten, whatever it is. Say, earlier, I mentioned that one of the things I found most confusing was in the Quran, the husband is supposed to determine how long the baby will nurse at the breast, which is like, huh?
Yeah.
What? I mean, that's absurd on the face of it.
Yeah, and that was from the Hadith, by the way.
Yes.
I mean, which is the teaching
now
of Muhammad.
Let's
show what the Quran says, actually, about also the status of women.
That's so Hadith.
This is based on 313 Hadith, 31 Hadith. This is based on 12,066 words in the Quran that you searched.
And there we have it. High status is 5%. Equal status is 23%. And inferior status is only 71%.
Only
71%.
Out of anything that dealt with women. So between the two primary sources, what Allah taught and what Muhammad taught.
Yes.
What is the conclusion then? Based on what we're seeing, the status of woman, at least as a low status, is the predominant status.
Yes, it's predominant. Let me show you. There was a Palestinian woman who went to a Sharia court. This is how the mind can become subjugated. She said, my husband beats me every day. I want a fatwa which says he can only beat me once a week.
Wow.
Think about the psychology of that. I only want my husband to beat me once a week. I don't know if they actually issued a fatwa or not, but I was just stunned by the fact that that was acceptable to her.
They won't even issue that fatwa, of course. She probably will have a fatwa against her for daring to ask for a fatwa.
Right.
I mean, sadly. By the way, not only Muhammad, of course, demonstrated that he has the capability of pinching, his wife, his companions, meaning those who lived with him, okay? These are the ones that we lived with him, his contemporaries. He was alive, okay? And they were doing this. So let's take an example. Omar, the second caliph of Islam, found the Prophet sitting sad and silent with his wives around him. So Omar decided to say something which would make the Prophet basically cheer up a little bit, okay? So he wanted him to laugh, so he said, Messenger of God, I wish you had seen the daughter of Kharija, talking about someone, when she asked me for extra money, okay, and I got basically up and slapped her on the neck. This is the joke that he's telling.
Right.
The Prophet.
Cheer him up.
He wanted to cheer the Prophet up by using a story that the one that was with me, the woman, asked me for extra money, so my reaction was I stood up and I slapped her. Now let's see how the reaction of the messenger. The messenger probably would have said, I can't believe you said something like this in front of my wives. Beside, how can you treat women like this? That's a prophet, right? This would have been the perfect opportunity for Muhammad to set what? The model.
Yes.
For others to do. So this, the God messenger laughed and said, they are around me, as you can see, asking for extra money. So in other words, Omar, what a brilliant idea that is. Should I go and slap each one of them right now? Is this how a leader should model his teaching to his own companions?
We can talk should or should not, but the fact is he did it. And by the way, for those, for the viewing audience, we need to understand, they need to understand that the companions of Muhammad are similar to the apostles of Jesus. That is,
that's right, exactly.
That is, some of what they said and did is also viewed as perfect behavior.
Because they were the ones with him.
Yes.
They saw how he acted and they tried to mimic it.
Right.
Exactly. And you know, just, I know some people are gonna complain and say, oh, that never happened. Okay, here's the source. Mishkat al-Masabih, volume 2, page number 690, okay? And Muslim, basically, hadith, book number 9, hadith number 3506. Hadith number 3506. Just in case. I don't want to get accused of fabricating things.
I'll tell you, Al, in our business, we don't need to we don't need to fabricate anything because the reality of it is outrageous enough.
That's right. So this is one topic that probably many people watching us right now, especially female, going to be very troubled by it. Now, here's another topic, the topic of inheritance in Islam. You know, you've done, I'm sure, some studies on it. You know that the Quran says that the share for a male is twice as much as a female. When you first came across something like this, how did you react to that? Or how did you process something like that?
Well, since I have daughters, I thought it was very unfair. But that is what it says. So that when I say it's fair to what I believe in, not what the doctrine believes in.
That's right. And the, you know, here is what's going on here. So, you know, you have basically the status of woman in terms of, you know, giving him the sources. And I wanted just to kind of read basically a hadith that is extremely troubling. So a woman came to the Prophet of Islam and says, why is it that a female gets, you know, less than a male? You would think the Prophet would have said, let me consult with Allah, you know, or, you know, I'm going to pray and may the Lord send me some wisdom in how to respond to this. His response was narrated, basically, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, the Prophet said, isn't the witness of a woman equal to half that of a man? Now, here's what he's doing. His answer was from the Quran using another passage that says, if you go to court and you bring witnesses with you, guess what, folks? You can bring two men. That's acceptable. But let's say you couldn't find two men. You can bring one man if you find one. But what about the other man? You bring two women to exactly. substitute for him. So Muhammad used that example. He said, isn't the testimony of a female basically, you know, half of that of a man, or testimony of a man equal two of a woman? And here is the answer. Why is that? The woman said, yes, of course. But she's still waiting for the answer, of course. His answer was, this is because of the deficiency of a woman's mind.
Mm-hmm.
This is the Prophet of Islam, who's the model for mankind, a mercy for mankind, actually. That's how he was described.
He goes, this is a very interesting hadith, which we're getting into, because it describes, in a one, if you had to give one item which would summarize the way women are treated in Islam, the hadith we're discussing here would be that. Because he goes further to say that the majority of hell will be filled with women.
That's right.
I mean, how inferior can you get? Because they were not grateful to their husbands.
That's right. You see, the criteria of husband is used a lot, especially on Judgment Day, actually.
Yes. Now, theoretically, on Judgment Day, the man and woman are equal, judged by their works. But, keep coming back to this, part of what the woman is to be judged by is how well did she obey her husband.
So that's part of her works.
That's part of her works, is to subjugate herself to the husband.
Absolutely.
And I've wondered how many women who have been beaten or badly treated in a marriage, who are desperately just looking for death in order they can get judgment day judgment, justice, because they're not getting it now. The woman who, the Palestinian woman who wanted to only be beat once a week, that is not justice.
That's right. That's right.
And by deficiency the way, in her intelligence.
Absolutely. Of course. I mean, there is a lot of women that we know in our lives, of course, who are extremely intelligent, more than capable to run organizations. They have their own ministries, I know some of them. They go to college, they are performing extremely well. To say something like this about them, how is that gonna encourage them? How is that gonna make them feel self-sufficient? How is that gonna make them feel good about who they are and what is their purpose in life? I mean, you compare this, you know, to other teaching, a Muslim woman who truly thinking through these kind of teachings can conclude right away that my purpose in life is to please a man.
Exactly.
That's pretty much what it is.
Exactly. And the way she's pleasing to the man is she subjugates herself to the man.
Absolutely, absolutely. And just to be on the safe side again, I want to give you that a source for the hadith that I just mentioned about a woman is deficient in her brain or mind. It's many sources have it, by the way, but this is one of examples. It's found in Hadith Bukhari or collection of Bukhari, volume 3, book number 48, hadith number 826. Hadith number 826. You know, Bill, there's a lot to talk about, and maybe when we come back again next time, we will explore other aspects of how women are being treated in Islam. Is there anything else you want to add to what we have covered so far?
I only wish that what we're saying here could be understood by everyone, including Muslim women, because everyone needs... What you and I are saying is Allah and Muhammad said and did these things, and this establishes what Islam actually is, not what we like to wish it would become, but what it actually is. That is, what we're doing here is fact-based reasoning.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I hope everyone here watching us will also do their fact check on everything that we are sharing with you. Until we meet again, have a blessed day. Thank you for watching. Please like our video, and we encourage you to subscribe to our YouTube channel, CIRA International. And be sure also to click the bell so that you receive notifications whenever we upload new videos into the channel. And finally, I like to prayerfully encourage you to become a patron through Patreon. Your giving is much needed and will enable us to produce more and more of videos like this so that we can publish them on a weekly basis. So thank you in advance.